how I would word the problem. The church teaches, rightly, that the Eucharist, the liturgy that we celebrate here, liturgy just means work. Huh? It means the work of the people, but it's really not the work of the people. It's the work of God, which is engaging us in a dialogue. I'll say more on that in a bit. But the liturgy, the Eucharist, what happens around here, around this altar and around this ambo, both this ambo and this altar, huh? The other day we sent out that survey. We got some comments from people. We got a lot of comments from people. People need to learn charity, by the way. I'm going to write an article, Whatever Happened to Charity? I mean that. Somehow we've gotten accustomed to writing things anonymously, and when we write them, somehow we just check charity at the door. There can be no place for that in the body of Christ. We're going to make comments. We need to make comments in love. We can be strong. We can be forceful. We can be direct. They got to be in love. And some of the comments weren't in love. But one of the comments that I remember was, I think it was an answer to, I wish that. So you might remember that was, I think, the last question in the survey. I wish that the altar was in the center of the sanctuary. This is actually what it's supposed to look like. Why? Because we as Catholics have tended to forget that what happens here is really important. Vatican II reminds us that we are fed from the two tables. This table, the table of the Word, and the table of the Word made flesh. It's not enough just to get in here for Mass in time for the Eucharistic prayer. If God's speaking, and that's what's happening when this is someone standing up here lending their voice to God, if God's speaking, we should be listening. And the balance between these two, with the presence of the Lord and the Blessed Sacrament in the center, helps to convey that very powerfully. It reminds us that I am fed in both places. Both places. And the Council goes on to say in Vatican II, in the document Dei Verbum, just as the faithful have venerated the body of the Lord in the Eucharist, so the faithful venerate the Lord in the Scriptures. So I always encourage people not to put their Bible on the ground. You would never put the Eucharist on the ground. The Word of God is the Word of God. Don't put the Bible on the ground. But that's how we're fed. Back to the problem. The church says that what happens around these two tables is the source and the summit of our life. It's the origin of everything, because God is the origin, and it is the high point, which is to say there is nothing that can happen on this earth that could possibly compare with what happens from these two tables. Nothing. Not winning a national championship, not getting a six-figure bonus, not getting news back that the cancer is benign. Nothing. Nothing compares. It's the high point, objectively speaking. The problem is, subjectively speaking, how many of us really experience that? 40% of our parish. This is an alive, active, dynamic, spirit-filled, engaged parish. 40% come to Mass. Obviously, it's not the source and summit of our life. Of the 40% who come, and I played this game, I'll tell you, 10%, I would guess, I'm telling you, maybe sometime this week you can just come up here and sit. Make sure you genuflect to the Eucharist, but sit here. Because when you sit here, you'll realize you can see everything. I mean, everything. I can't see the people who are walking behind me. That's why it's no big deal, really. But I can see everything here. So you just notice, wow, like 10% of the congregation walked in the first reading. Huh. And I have no words to properly express my admiration, my respect, my appreciation for those of you, especially with kids at home, and the struggle it is to get them here and to get them here on time. I have tremendous respect for you, okay? So leaving them to the side, although you do know what time Mass is every week, right? But leaving them to the side, what's the deal with the rest of us? So, you know, you just kind of realize 10% came in and we missed the first reading. So what are we saying there? There was nothing there for me. It was irrelevant. I'm just here to check the box. And then maybe 15% leave right after communion. Man, it varies from Mass to Mass, you know. It's always fun walking down the aisle because people walk out, like right in front of me. And I'm walking down the aisle. The cross bearer has to wait because someone's in front of him and he can't get out. That's not the source and summit, right? I had life team tonight. I was walking out. Don't mean to put anybody in the spot, but I'm walking out and granted, sometimes it's hard to sing in the pitch as you guys sing, okay? So I'll cut them some slack for that. But still, I'm looking in the cry room, and there's a set of adults, and they have the sheet in their hand, but there's nothing coming out of their mouth. I mean, the mouth isn't even moving. If this was really, if we subjectively experienced it as the source and summit of our life, we would sing. You want to see singing? Go to a Michigan football game. Go to a Michigan State basketball game. Go to a concert. You'll see people sing. You'll hear people sing. Somehow the same people walk in here and whoop, lost my voice. Lost it at the football game yesterday, actually. But our model should be Augustine. Now, music's all taste, granted, all right? The only two things outside of the Eucharist that should change at every Mass are the preaching and the music. And those get more comments than anything. Because music is art. All different kinds of art attract different kinds of people. So there's diverse kinds of music here and in every parish. But singing is essential to worship. Not just because the saints used to say, when you sing, you pray twice. But because I'm engaged bodily. And we're engaged as a community, praying and singing together. It's a manifestation of who we are as a community. And when we come to Mass, this is really important. We might say more about this on Tuesday night, but this is not me and Jesus, or not only me and Jesus. It's not the me and Jesus two-step, as a priest friend of mine says in a homily that I'm going to hand out later. This is us. This is us together as the body of Christ. My time to be with the Lord in a unique way is before Mass, listening to the scriptures, where he's speaking very personally to me. But I know lots of people, and I was one of them, like right after communion, I'm not here to sing. This is my time with the Lord. I got to get out of that mentality. That is not the right mentality. That's after Mass. Here, it's us together praising God for what it is that he has just given us, himself. I don't think, anyway, most Catholics truly experience the Eucharist and the liturgy as the source and summit of our life. And so back to the origins of this, there is a burden, to be sure, on us who are ordained to help do something about that. I studied for 5.5 years. This is all I did. This wasn't like you coming home from work and checking out some websites and some blogs and some good Catholic books. I mean, I was immersed in this. So granted, I should be somewhat more familiar with some things than most people, although not all people. I've got some friends who put me to shame with what it is that they know, and they are very busy people. But in the document on the liturgy in Vatican II, it says this. This is paragraph 11 for those of you who take notes or whatnot. It says, in order that the liturgy may be able to produce its full effects, it is necessary that the faithful come to it with proper dispositions, that their minds be attuned to their voices, that they cooperate with heavenly grace, lest they receive it in vain. Pastors of souls must, therefore, realize that when the liturgy is celebrated, something more is required than the laws governing valid and lawful celebration. Like, it's not just important that I say the right words. That's important, by all means, but we need more than that. It is their duty, our duty, this is on us, to ensure that the faithful take part fully aware of what they're doing, actively engaged in the rite and enriched by it. That's the hope for these couple of days, to help be a means, and it will only be a means by all means, to help us better understand what's going on here. What we're going to try to do can by no way be exhaustive. In fact, I was thinking that in many ways, these days are something like a compendium or a companion to a whole series of resources which I want to make you aware of. I've got a to you about it. So many of us don't like books. Like, is that on tape? Yep, it's on tape. You can even watch them. It's exceptional. So I want to try to be a catalyst a bit in these days, and then kind of send you on the way, which is really what I want to do. It's going to go back to the exhortation at the end. So two things that I want to try to communicate tonight. The first is I get it. I get this disconnect between the objective teaching that the Eucharist is the source and summit of our life and our subjective experience of, really? Because that was me for a long, long, long time. I grew up, as many of you know from different things that I've shared in the past, in an extremely devout family, a very ecumenical family. My dad was Catholic, my mom was Methodist. My mom didn't convert to Catholicism or come into communion with the church until shortly after Pope John Paul II was elected. One of the highlights, really, of her life was right when I was ordained a deacon, which was in Rome. We had a chance, the three of us, to meet Pope John Paul together, which was great. The three of us together, we'd all met him individually, but and a chance for her to thank the Holy Father, soon to be blessed, John Paul II, for really bringing her into the church. I think he was in Chicago at the time. It was his first visit to the United States. I think it was in Chicago, and he was singing to the kids, and they were singing back to him, and then he kind of walked out onto the porch. It was like 12:30 at night. He says, "Even the Holy Father has to go to bed, go to sleep." And he just had this engaging, magnetic way. If you remember John Paul, especially when he was young, he just had a charisma and a magnetism to him, which was much like Augustine. He's easily one of the 10 greatest people who ever lived. And she saw that. She turned to my dad. She says, "I have no more objections to the Catholic Church," and came into the church. But as a kid growing up, until I was maybe 14 or so, we went to church every Sunday, at least my mom and dad and my brother and I. My sisters were married by this time. They all got married by the time I was 8. My dad built an addition to our house in 1973, because he needed a bigger house for our family. The year he built the addition, all three of his daughters got married. Interesting timing. So I'm at Mass every week. They didn't give me an option. Parents shouldn't give a child an option. I just think parents should say to a child, you know, you have every right to not like what I'm saying to you. You have every right to be angry with me. You have every right to kick and scream. Doesn't matter. You're coming to Mass. Because one day you're going to understand what's going on. It's like saying to a kid who doesn't want to go to school, "Nah, I'm not going to school." "Nah, you're right, stay home, I'm not going to fight with you." We understand the value of going to school. We need to understand the value of coming here and of what happens here. There's no way we can not let that happen. My parents certainly didn't. But I don't ever recall waking up in the morning going, "Ooh, church." But I do remember, I remember this very well. I remember two distinct experiences. I remember walking out of Mass. And my dad loves to sing, so we sang every verse, you know. There was no way you got out early, and people knew who my dad was, so there was no way he was letting his son leave early either. So we sang for every verse. And I can remember, much as I might have kicked and screamed about that, the feeling of, that was just right. I was balking at it the whole way, but I walked, I got in the car, and I thought, that was a good thing to have done. I remember that experience. And I remember the experiences later in my life when I didn't go to church, of going to bed Sunday night going, this was wrong. And I remember that very well. As I got older and church got to be a very difficult place for me to be. I didn't understand what was happening. I knew something was going on up here. Like I knew, I've shared before, my earliest memory, I have no childhood memories. My earliest memory is about 7 years old, with the exception of Neil Armstrong walking on the moon. I remember looking at the cross in Holy Name Parish and somehow just knowing that happened for me. I just knew that. Somehow it had a claim on my life. Didn't know anything else, but I knew that. And I sensed that when I came to church, what was happening up here was really important, but I didn't have a clue. And there got to be a point in my life where as I got older, I could have figured it out. I mean, I could have asked somebody. I could have read a book. I could have talked to my mom and dad. I didn't take any initiative. I just didn't learn anything. I just continued to live in kind of like intentional ignorance, like a number of us can or did. I also didn't know the scriptures very well. My mom and dad did. My sisters really did. My parents read scripture every morning. I saw their Bibles lying out all the time. I knew it was important to read, but you know, scriptures are difficult enough. The scriptures that are read at Mass are very difficult because they're read out of context. I remember one of the Life Teen lectors came to see me a couple years ago. Just walked in before Mass and said, "I don't have a clue what this means. This is 3 minutes before Mass." I said, "You know, you had a week to to call me and say, what am I reading?" But I didn't know the scriptures very well, which made this table to be almost irrelevant for me. I just pinned my hopes on the guy with the funny robes would say something that would help me get it, which is what many of us do. One of the biggest things that I did, I know, and that I'm sure many of us do, I came to church with a mentality that wanted to be entertained. That's what I want whenever I go somewhere, unless I'm going to the hospital or to a cemetery or a funeral home, which is pretty common for us, especially this week. I go somewhere because I want entertainment. I want something for my time. But Mass is not entertaining. Point blank, it's just not entertaining. It's not supposed to be entertaining. That's not the point. We often lose people over that. They go to this church or this church down the street, wherever, because it's lively. That gets old. I can get livelier things on my CDs. I got really lively CDs. But we can lose oftentimes, we can deceive ourselves, or simply not get it if we come here thinking, okay, I'm here, you've got my attention now for 45 minutes, and it better not be longer. Entertain me. Sing something I like, say something to make me laugh, make me feel good. That's why I'm here. Make me feel good. Jesus didn't become man and die to make me feel good. Jesus became man and died to make me good. It's a big difference. The cross doesn't feel good. Grieving the loss of your wife doesn't feel good, but I need an answer to that. Continuing to mourn my daughter doesn't feel good, but I need an answer to that. Struggling with sickness and cancer and prayers which seemingly go unanswered don't make me feel good, but I need an answer to that. There's an answer here if I'll engage, if I'll listen, if I'll respond. So I had to get out of an entertainment mentality. I want to say a little bit more about that tomorrow, just some real practical steps to help us better get situated for what's going to happen here so that it doesn't just fly over our heads and become the mere experience of checking off the box, which does no good. God isn't going to look at you when you die and go, Ricardo, what was your envelope number? 666. Curious? Perfect attendance. Excellent. Come on in. That's not what it's about. It is important to be here, but we're not here to check off a box. God sees my heart, not just where my footprints are. He sees my heart. Another significant thing for me anyway, and maybe you can identify with this in your past, or you probably wouldn't be here right now. When I got to a certain point in my life and I really began to walk away from God, church became the worst place to go. When I really began to live a selfish life, I didn't want to look at that. That was very uncomfortable. That was convicting. That was a reminder of who God is, what he's done for me, and what I'm supposed to be doing in return, and I did not want to be reminded of that. So the easy thing to do was just stop going. So I did. I just stopped going. God's gaze from a cross, which is not condemning at all. God does not condemn. God just begs from the cross, going, what are you doing? Why would you turn away from me? Why would you not trust me? Who's done for you what I've done for you? Why do you run away? It's like today we hear the story of the fall of Adam and Eve. And immediately after this, God cries out to Adam, Adam, where are you? It's not because God doesn't know where Adam is. The point of the question is, where are you so I can help you? I want to bring you back. I didn't make you to die. I made you for life. Where are you? That's what he's saying from the cross. But I didn't want to hear that. I didn't want to come back. I didn't trust him. I still wanted to do what I wanted to do, perhaps like some of us in our past, or perhaps like some of us in our presence. By college, I pretty much stopped going to church altogether. I went on Christmas, Easter, when I went home, or my parents would have some choice words for me. When I got called to the priesthood, I wasn't going to Mass. So I can remember like it was this morning, the encounter I had with the Lord, where he called me to live single and to do it as a priest. And my first response after I said, what? Was, Lord, I don't even go to church. I mean, I didn't go to Mass when he called me to priesthood. I knew two priests that I thought highly of. That was it. And they both scared the living daylights out of me. I thought they could read my soul. They used to come over. They were friends of my parents. They'd sit at dinner. Bobby, how you doing? How's college? Fraternity, huh? Yeah, I went to college. And it wasn't Franciscan. So I share all this with you because I want you to know, much like I kind of shared some of my story last year, I want you to know I get the struggles that we have here. I've been through them. And I want you to know that so if you have them, you can come and talk, because that's the only way we can grow. Even my last semester in seminary, so I'm already ordained a deacon, and I can remember sitting in the last pew of our chapel in Rome. I'm 3 months from getting ordained, and I am begging God as I'm looking at my life in the future. I have no doubts that he's calling me to priesthood. I can't wait by this point to be a priest. Can't wait to preach. Can't wait to teach. Can't wait to interact with youth. I knew I was going to a high school. I couldn't wait to interact with them. Couldn't wait to work with couples. Couldn't wait to hear confessions. But I didn't want to say Mass at all. I just kept saying, Lord, you got to help. I don't get it. I'm not excited about this. I know it's like the only thing I know I'm going to do every day of my life, but I don't understand what we're doing. So help me. And that week, the week after, shortly after I made that prayer for a number of times, I walked into a class. It was an elective that I had taken. The class happened to be taught by a guy named Father Jeremy Driscoll. It was a class on the liturgy and what God reveals to us about himself through it. And it forever changed my life. He is an exceptional teacher, and it changed everything for me. So I pray that it will help to change things for you too if you're in that kind of a place. What's happening here? Real quick. And then an exhortation, and then we'll pick up our kids. Put another way, what does God want? Because see, it's really important to understand that when we come to church, we're here. Clearly, we're here because we've freely chosen to come to any Mass. Church is kind of loosely based on the Greek word ekklesia, which is based on the Hebrew word kahal. And kahal means the assembled, the called. That implies a caller and an assembler. Someone has invited us here. The someone is God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He's invited us here because he wants something. And before we think that he wants my life, which he does, he wants to give something. He wants to give access to him. He wants us to know him, not because these stupid people should know me, but because it pleases me, he says, that they would know me. It pleases me for you to be my friend. That's God. He who needs nothing. It pleases him for you to respond to his offer of friendship. That delights him. That's his plan. That's why he made everybody who's not just here, who comes to Mass, everybody on the face of the earth. He made everyone for friendship, to share in his own life, to be divinized. That's why he made you, to be divinized, to be by adoption what God is by nature. God is not boring. Don't worry about going to heaven and being bored. This is boring. I'm boring. God is not boring. God is infinite joy, sheer happiness, unending delight, sweetness like we cannot imagine, beauty beyond anything we've ever seen. The saints used to say that we have to die before we can see God, because if we saw God now, we would explode. He is so beautiful. That's who God is. He has to be that way. Look at the beauty that he's made, which pleases the senses as much as they do. And the God who made all of that has made you to share in his own life. And that happens like nowhere else here in this place. This is where we most touch being divinized. This is where we get access to God. Access to God's in lots of places, huh? Scriptures, the church. But above all, access to God happens in the Eucharist, where regardless of whether we're conscious of it or not, we are meeting Jesus. Do you ever think of the fact that he's up here handing himself to you and me? There's someone else on the other side of the exchange giving himself to us. And it's an incredibly intimate act. It's two becoming one. It's an amazingly intimate act. That pleases God. As Mother Teresa used to say about these words which are underneath the cross, I thirst. Make sure we understand what the words mean. They don't just mean I love you. They mean that, but they mean much more than that. They mean I want you. I desire you. I long for you. That's far more passionate than most of us want him to be. We just want him to be like the safety valve. God's got far grander things in store for us. That's why he refers to the church as his bride. So God is making himself known here. That's what's going on. We're going to say much more on this tomorrow night and then Tuesday night. Technically speaking, three things happen in every sacrament, but especially in the Eucharist. It recalls something, it makes something present, and it foretells something. So, for example, every time we come to Mass, we're in heaven. That's really comforting for those of us who've lost loved ones. We're really all together with our loved ones who are either already home in heaven in glory or on their way through the fires of purgatory. We're all together, even if it's just 25 of us in the day chapel at 6:30 Mass, or if it's 1,500 of us here on Easter Sunday. The whole church is present, even though we can't see them. That's part of the point, that's actually the main point behind all these statues. It's not just to have art, it's to remind us where we are when we come to Mass, and where we come is we come to heaven. And Mary's there, and Joseph's there, and Peter, and Andrew, and Paul, and John, and James, and Matthew. They're all there. My grandpa, my uncle who just died, the people we just buried this week, the people who died last night, we're all together. The whole church is there. It is a foretaste of the banquet of heaven. And as my first pastor, Monsignor Cusick, a Divine Child, used to say, said this at the first funeral I ever went to, at every Mass, when the Eucharist is held up, the Eucharist becomes like a two-way mirror between us and those we love who are home. We see what looks like bread that's not bread. They are on the other side. They see the Lord. And our eyes meet in him. That's a really comforting reality for those of us who continue to grieve and mourn and miss those we love whom God has taken from our sight. And it's not just an idea, it's a reality, it's true. This is a taste of heaven. Whether it's a beautiful church or a jeep in the middle of Afghanistan with a chaplain saying Mass for his troops, you're in heaven. But I want to touch for a second here on this idea that there is an event happening. When you and I come to Mass, nothing less than God saving us is happening. That's what's going on. There was an event 2,000 years ago where God worked in history to save us. That same event continues, though it happened once, for all. It happens in the rite that we celebrate on this altar. God is saving me. Couldn't help but think of that tonight at Mass, mindful of some friends of mine. I was praying with their mother this afternoon, who's in critical condition, holding up the chalice, hearing Jesus' words, "This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all." How much they need to hear that right now, just to be reminded that they are in God's hands, that their mother is in God's hands. But for the people who I know who are here at Mass, who are struggling with sins, who need to be reminded that there's hope for them. It will be shed so that sins may be forgiven. Therefore, I've got a place to go. I can run to him. I don't have to run from him. I can run to him. Christ saves us here. It's God's work. And you and I are being addressed in it. It's a dialogue. This is so important, I think, for us when we come to Mass, to realize we are not observing something. We're participating in something. This line, you know, that Jesus says, "Do this in memory of me," or "Do this in remembrance of me," when he holds up the chalice. That does not mean do this and just kind of vaguely think about what it is I did for you a long time ago. The word in Greek is anamnesis. It's an extremely technical word. And we know what it means from our Jewish brothers and sisters who, when they celebrate the Passover today, they know that when they celebrate it, their experience is they are participating now in the Exodus. They're being rescued from slavery. It's not just they're thinking about what happened back 4,000 years ago with the Israelites in Egypt. No, tonight, they're leaving Egypt. That's what they know when they celebrate the Passover. And when we hear those words, the Lord reminds us right now, the event, what event? The event of his death, the event of his total offering for you and me, the greatest demonstration of love, it's happening. The event of his empty tomb, which shatters death, because the altar is the place of his non-tomb. That's what this is. That's what Driscoll calls it. This table is the place of Jesus' non-tomb. He is not there. He's not dead. We do not gather together to tell stories about what a great guy Jesus was. Hope we can live like him. That's not a Christian. A Christian is someone who declares and accepts as true the message that the one who is dead on a cross is alive, and he's alive for me, and he's alive for me to wash away my sins and to crush the power of death. And I believe it. That's what amen means. I believe it. I bank my life on that. That is my only hope. And those of us who are sitting here who are grieving tonight, and I know there are, I need to know that and be reminded of that, But death does not have the last word. He does, because he's really done something about it. He's really alive. And because he's alive, he's here. He's present. He speaks, and he wants an answer. He wants an answer to all that he has done for us. And he wants to know, who else would we give an answer to who could have a claim on us like he does? My favorite image for what happens at Mass is the movie Saving Private Ryan, which I know I use kind of ad nauseum, but I find it to be a tremendous image. Saving Private Ryan, for those of you who haven't seen, is a story about a brother who's fighting in World War II, whose other brothers have all died. The War Department finds out about it, so they send a group of troops on a mission to rescue this guy, hence the title Saving Private Ryan. It starts with him, an old man, he's my father's age, kind of late 80s, with his family kind of walking behind him, walking to Normandy. He's walking down the shores of Normandy where D-Day happened. He fought in D-Day. And he walks into this huge cemetery. If you've been to Normandy, you've seen it. And he starts walking through these rows and rows and rows of graves, which are crosses and stars of David. And finally, he stops in front of one grave, which is a cross. And he looks at the cross, and the camera zooms into his eye, and then you go into this flashback. It's June 6, 1944, and then you're there for about 2.5 more hours. After it ends with the last scene of the flashback where the man who saved him dying, and as he's dying, he grabs Private Ryan, and he whispers in his ear, "Earn this." And Ryan says, "What?" And he says, "Earn it." And then he dies. And then it zooms out of that and back to modern times, and it's the old man standing at the grave, which you come to find out is the grave of the man who said that to him, "Earn this." I love that image so much because we have those kinds of experiences, maybe not as dramatic as that, maybe more dramatic than that, depending upon our lives and our histories, of looking at something, whether it's a picture or driving by a house that we used to live in or a loved one used to live in. We see things. We're sensual people. We see things. We hear things. We smell things. That's really powerful for most of us. And it takes us back to another place. You ever have that happen? Walk past and you smell something. It's like, whoa, it's 1981. Where am I? Depending upon what you smell, right? Or you hear a song and it takes you back to first date or your wedding or to a funeral or whatever. But those are only in our memories. It's not really happening. It's just a memory. What happens here is much more powerful. This is not a memory like that. When we come to Mass, the event of the cross and the event of the empty tomb of Jesus are here in our midst, or rather, we're there. We become contemporaries of the cross. We're standing every time we come to Mass at the foot of the cross, and the wounds of Christ are still moist. They're still fresh. Not because he's dying again, he's died once for all, but because his sacrifice is present to us now, sacramentally. We're there. And that is the greatest event in human history, and there is no event that is more important or could be more important to be present at. It blows being at a Final Four out of the water. It blows being anywhere out of the water because those things are diversions from the harsh realities of life, especially the harshest reality of life, which is death. This is not a diversion. This is an answer to that. This is a response to death. This is the refutation of death, which enables me to enjoy the diversions for what they are. And at the conclusion of every Mass, we're sent out, we're kicked out by God to tell people where we just were, by what we say and how we live above all, to live as men and women of hope, confident that we have a God who cares so much that he's broken into history and has done something about the problem that is sin and death. The only thing that everybody in this church knows without fail is going to happen to us. I am going to die. I'm going to lie in a box one day, and I better have an answer for it. And God's got an answer for it. He's done something about it. He's killed it. He's shamed it. He's routed it. He's humiliated it. He's stripped it of its power. It's become a doorway home. That's all death is. That's why St. Francis could call death Sister Death, because you're just the way home. Only someone with faith can say that. That's what we're sent to do when we leave here. And the reason it's so important is because, quite frankly, every human heart is longing to know this. We aren't, as Christians, simply offering the world a message. We're offering the world what the world longs for and what God wants, to become new creations. The reality that I can start over. That's going to happen at Easter when a set of folks are going to be baptized and they're going to bury their old lives in the water of that font and they're going to emerge as new creations. It happens every time you and I walk out of a confessional. I'm a new creation. Even if I walked in with the same old garbage I've been confessing for 45 years, I'm a new creation. I got a new chance. I can start all over again. And one day I'm going to be divinized. And so are you. So what's the exhortation? And the exhortation is this. I continue to sense that we, particularly as a parish family, and I'm mindful that we got visitors and I'm glad to have you, and so maybe this is going to apply to you too, I'm sure it does, but I know it's true for us. I'm convinced the Lord wants to kind of push us. Push us in the sense of, I have to take responsibility for my faith. I have to own this. I have to do something about this. I have to take the initiative with this. There are so many avenues for us to learn. Podcasts, books, YouTube videos, songs. We have countless talks that we give here at the parish, other parishes, men's conferences, women's conferences, you name it. We have so many opportunities to learn the faith. And I think for some of us anyway, we've kind of gotten into the habit of looking to the church to do what I need to do, to feed me in a way that I need to feed myself. It's almost like the Lord's saying, we've been drinking milk for a long time. We need to move to solid food. We need to move into the next step of maturity. Mindful that we are all in a variety of places. Some of you are much closer to the Lord than me. I just happen to have a collar. That doesn't mean anything. I know that. We can all grow so much. But the next stage of growth is going to be me realizing, I got to do something about this. There's no excuse for me not knowing more. No excuse. I got time for anything that I love. A DVR, whatever it is that I need to watch. And I watch it at 2 a.m. if I have to. We got time for what we love. Hence back to the prayer for passion. I want to encourage us and exhort us tonight to simply ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, give me a desire for God. He has to do that. And he wants to do that. He really wants to do that. Give me a desire for God. Give me a desire to know. Because the one who loves can't know enough. I hear it all the time in a marriage. You know, somebody gets turned on to the faith, the other person doesn't, and the response is, why do you do this all the time? You don't have to do all this. And the response is, because I want to. Because I want to know him more. It used to be just a bunch of rules and regulations and things to do. It's not that anymore. Now I've met him and everything's different. Now I want to know him. But we got to ask God to do that. So let's pray for ourselves individually and for us as a parish family for that gift of passion and desire which filled Augustine and all the saints and so many of our family members down through the ages. Second, I think we have to get into a mentality of when I come to Mass, I have to expect something. That's part of the problem. We don't expect anything. That's why we want entertainment. But I only want entertainment if I don't know nothing else is happening. But God is speaking to me here. He's engaging in a dialogue. He's waiting for a response. We're going to talk much more about this tomorrow night. So pray when I come to Mass, especially Wednesday night, if you can come to Mass at the conclusion of the mission. But next time you're at Mass, tomorrow morning, for those of you who go to daily Mass, ask the Lord, Lord, help me to expect something. Ask yourself, what am I expecting when I come to Mass? Because something's happening. I mean, it's really happening. And we'll say some things practically tomorrow to do that. That'll help us maybe do that. Third and lastly, I want to encourage us every day in the mission to spend some time prayerfully reading John 6. Somewhat a long chapter, 70-some verses. It's known as Jesus' Bread of Life discourse. It's where he speaks to us in a most remarkable way about the gift that is himself in the Eucharist. We need to spend some time personally with it, asking the Lord, Lord, what are you saying to me in this? I don't get this. Or I do get it, help me to understand it better. But every time I read Scripture, now Scripture is inspired, which doesn't just mean that the Holy Spirit inspired the authors to write it. It means that the Holy Spirit inspires me to get it. You don't need to be a Scripture scholar to read Scripture. Scripture scholars just mess it up. You need to have faith. That's what you need. So pray with John 6. Lunch hour at work, tonight before you go to bed, tomorrow morning when you're praying, whatever. And then every day, tonight, tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday. And just let that truth about the Eucharist and what it is that Jesus gives to us there soak in and kind of prepare us for what will be the culmination of what it is that we do come Wednesday night. How about we close by asking the intercession of our patroness? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, Pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Our Lady of Good Counsel. See you tomorrow.
Thank you for listening to Christ is the Answer with Father John Ricardo. To download or podcast this program, go to AveMariaRadio.net and click on Archive. For your own CD copy, without waiting for an operator, go to AveMariaRadio.net and click on Store. Today's show is program number 807. Join us next time for Christ is the Answer on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
Pong napakinggan ay programa mula sa Eternal Word Television Network o EWTN na mapapakinggan tuwing alauna hanggang alas dos ng hapon dito sa DZSB 104.1 Spirit FM. Maraming salamat po sa walang sawa ninyong pagtangkilik.
Oh.
2 o'clock here at 104.1 Spirit FM.
Lilipat ka pa ba? Siyempre hindi na. Tutok lang, best friend. Spirit FM.
Aiming for something great? Dream with us at DZSPFM. A proud member of CMN, the Catholic Media Network.
Hanap mo ba'y kaibigan?
Mega Life Drugstore, matatagpuan sa Calapan City Public Market Site at Literio Street, San Vicente, Calapan City.
Mababang presyo bang hanap mo sa pagpili ika'y litong-lito?
Pag nang mag-ato bili, pumunta na at tayo'y bibili.
Mga suki, para sa quality appliances at furniture, sa VPR po tayo magtiwala. Pasyal po kayo sa VPR Lalud, VPR San Vicente, and now open to serve you, VPR Filipiniana. Lowest cash prices with the best customer service. Tuloy po kayo sa VPR Lalud, VPR San Vicente, VPR Filipiniana.
Alingaw Ngaw, a church-based radio program hatid sa inyo ng Diocesan Commission on Mass Media of Apostolic Vicariate of Calapan. Mapapakinggan tuwing Sabado, alas 2 hanggang alas 3 ng hapon. Dito lamang po yan sa inyong paboritong radio station, ang himpilang kasama mo sa biyahe ng buhay. DZSB 104.1 Spirit FM.
Iba't ibang gamot para sa iba't ibang sakit,
isa lang dapat!
Mag-Rexidol Forte! Taob ang binat, sakit ng ulo, sakit ng katawan at lagnat!
Nakasanin sa hapat! Rexidol Forte!
Unilab yan.
Paracetamol plus caffeine is the generic name of Rexidol Forte. If symptoms persist, consult your doctor.
Marami na ang nagpatunay na epektibo ang Sagdon Plus Herbal Capsule.
Ang pinira ko, Fernando, Rizal, mambaro ko yung Palawan.
Anong masasabing mo sa Sagdon Plus Herbal Capsule, ma'am?
Eh, talagang magaling yun. Talaga yun ang nakagaling sa akin. Kasi halos dugo. Dugo na talagang sinisinga ko. Pag singa ko pa, akala ko sigol. Yun pala, dugo na. Tapos ang daming bukol na sumutugo sa ilong ko. Namaga na talaga yung ilong ko, dog.
So, atis ngayon, ma'am, nawala na pamamaga. Nawala na rin yung dugo na lumalabas sa tingnan mo, ma'am.
Wala lang, so matagal lang nawala, magaling, matagal na talaga.
Para sa malusog na katawan, inom na sa Sandton Plus Herbal Capsule.
Philippines, number one, Spirit FM.
to fly. I'm not that naive. I'm just out to find the better part of me. I'm more than a bird, I'm more than a plane, I'm more than some pretty face beside a train. And it's not easy to be me. I wish that I could cry, fall upon my knees, find a way to lie about a home I'll never see. It may sound absurd, but don't be naive. Even heroes have the right to bleed. I may be disturbed, but won't you concede? I can't stand to fly. I'm not that naive. Men want men to ride with clouds.
Song was brought to you by
Mega Life. Kamot ay laging bago, maaasahan mo.
Mega Life Drugs. Spirit 104.1.
I remember all my life, raining down as cold as ice. Shadows of a man goes into morning, just another day. Happy people pass my way. Looking in their eyes, I see a memory. I never realized how happy you made me. Oh man, well, you came and you gave without taking, but I sent you away. Stop me from shaking. just not right. But girl, you know that I would never, ever let another touch come between the two of us. 'Cause no one else will ever take your place. No one else can.
Was brought to you by
iBerry, mabibili sa mga suking butika sa inyong lugar.
Spirit 104.1.
You found me at the bottom of a bottle, drowning in the depths of my sorrow. A stranger too far to forgive, dying with no will to live. Then you held me so close to your heart, and you told me it's gonna be alright. You're the reason that I'm still alive. These are more than just words that I'm again. There ain't no mistaking, you have been waiting. Thank you for saving my life.